Welcome to EPG Patashala. My name is Dugirala Vasanta. I am on the teaching faculty of Department of Linguistics at Usmania University, Hyderabad. Today's lecture relates to Psychoneurolinguistics Course 10, Module 16. I will be talking about Introduction, History and Scope of Neurolinguistics. The objectives of today's lecture is to introduce the discipline of neurolinguistics through some of the questions it has tried to address and to describe three major approaches used in studying these questions. Let me say a little bit about the scope of neurolinguistics itself. Neurolinguistics belongs to the discipline of neuroscience, which attempts to explain brain mechanisms that regulate higher mental functions, including both verbal and nonverbal aspects of communication. Neuroscience has several branches, many of which I'm sure you're familiar: neurology, neuroanatomy, neurophysiology, neuropathology, neurosurgery, neuroradiology, neuroembryology, neuropsychology, and neurolinguistics. Neurosciences deal with various cognitive, systemic, cellular, sensory, and movement related functions of the nervous system. Neurolinguistics is only one branch of neuroscience. It's a branch of cognitive neuroscience which deals with the role of brain in processes underlying language acquisition, language processing, and language disorders. What are some of the questions addressed by neurolinguistics? How does brain and nervous system support human communication processes, both verbal and nonverbal? Is the processing of language different during the first and second language learning? Do structural and functional changes in the brain affect language use and understanding in older adults? In what specific ways language gets affected after brain damage? And is this different across different languages? How can we measure brain processes underlying language skills like listening, reading, speaking, writing, signing, etc.? How to design offline behavioral or real-time experiments in language processing? How to build computational models of activities involving language? What is the role of modality, that is vision, audition, in language processing? What is the nature of interface between language and general cognitive abilities? It's obvious that I will not be able to deal with all these questions in this lecture. I will focus on a few points, especially giving some idea about the history of development of neurolinguistics. And I will do this across three major approaches, starting with localism. This approach originated with Franz Joseph Gall in Paris. His time was 1758 to 1828. Then associationism. One of the main person associated with associationism is Karl Wernicke, a German neurologist. He subscribed this view he was born in 1848 and he was there till 1905. These ideas of associationism eventually became connectionism much later. We will talk about that in another module. Then third approach is holism, associated with Hewling Jackson, an English neurologist, 1835 to 1911. I will say a little more about each of these three approaches. Localism, and I said Gall is associated with it, the French neurophysician. Gall proposed a doctrine called phrenology, which is a study of a person's character in relation to external configuration of his or her skull. He argued that it is possible to detect the strength of particular human faculties from the shape and size of the cranium, the skull. And he also said that the faculty of words was located in the frontal lobe, and its primary purpose was to serve as means of expression. Gall's approach gave rise to the discipline, eventually to the discipline of neuropsychology, which is concerned with study of behavior in relation to anatomy and physiology of the brain. Another name connected to localism or localizationist approach to neurolinguistics is Paul Broca, 1824 to 1880. He encountered a patient who could only say one syllable called tan. He would just go around saying tan, tan, tan. So when he died, Broca operated on him, dissected his brain and found an area in the brain which was damaged, which obviously is related to his problem of expression. And so Broca said that that particular area, which is the third frontal convolution in the left hemisphere, is the seat of articulate language, and therefore third frontal convolution came to be known as Broca's area. Let's look at the picture of brain left hemisphere. Notice there is an arrow pointing to the Broca's area. Little later, in 1874, the German neurologist called Wernicke described another area in the temporal lobe called which came to be known as Wernicke's area. And Broca's area is in the frontal lobe, Wernicke's area is in the posterior parts, that is in the temporal lobe. And this area is originally associated with understanding, comprehension of speech. Broca's is production, Wernicke's is comprehension. So basically, this idea of assigning a given particular brain structure with a particular function is what is called localization or localism. Now let's move to the next slide. Associationism. According to this view, connections between different parts of the brain are more important than the areas themselves. So it is the strength of the connection that allows us to understand and use language. So brain centers involved in processing images, for instance, they have to be connected to centers involved in processing heard sounds, which in turn have to be connected to motor area in the frontal lobe, which sends instructions down to our speech muscles to open our mouth and speak. So there have to be connections between comprehension area, production area to motor area. Motor area sends signals down to the speech muscles. So it is these associations which are important, not particular locations. This is why it is called associationism. So as I said, Carl Wernicke and later Norman Geschwind talked about associationism and also about existence of a particular aphasia called sensory aphasia, resulting from lesion of associative fibers which are connecting temporal lobe to third frontal convolution in the left hemisphere, that is the Broca's area. You see in the picture on the screen, the blue area is the Wernicke's area, the red area is the Broca's area, and you see a band of white fibers connecting the two. This association is what they are emphasizing, you know, as playing an important role in language functions. Associationism continued into later Ludwig Lich time, 1845 to 1928. He also endorsed Wernicke's ideas and confirmed the existence of what came to be known as conduction aphasia in 1884, when he described a case characterized by severe problem in repeating words. In conduction aphasia, where the problem is with the connections, which are the fibers connecting the Wernicke's area with the Broca's area, when those connections are affected, patients experience problems in repeating, and it came to be known as conduction aphasia. And several other French neurologists and Norman Geschwind in particular supported associationism, in fact Geschwind published a book called Disconnection Syndromes in 1965. So associationism survived and it became connectionism later on. So what is this connectionism and in what way is it different from associationism? Forging links with computer scientists, the neuroscientists turned what was called associationism into connectionism. Connectionism basically relies on the idea that the mind brain is composed of simple nodes, say neurons, and that the power of the system comes primarily from the existence and manner of connections between different nodes or neural networks. So, you see on the screen a very simple network model, trying to explain connectionism has been shown to you. Connectionists, meaning people who endorse connectionism, they argue against existence of rules, which is what generative linguists did. They say there is no need to posit rules. Instead, association, the strength of association in these connections between different nodes, node can be treated as a neuron. So, those strength of connection is what is important. So, then moving on to the third major approach to study of neurolinguistics called holism. Holism denies existence of specific anatomical brain structures that control equally specific language functions, which is what localism did. Holism also is not happy with the associationism or the connectionism. Hewling-Jackson, who was a major proponent of holism, argued that cerebral lesions which cause aphasia result in what he called negative signs and positive signs. Aphasia is a sign of general cognitive deficit and not limited to language alone. Later, Henry Head and Goldstein are also agreed with Jackson and endorsed the holism approach. So, according to holism, the loss of speech in aphasia is loss of our ability to propositionalize, to develop propositions. Jackson makes a distinction between higher language functions and automatic linguistic processes. What an aphasic loses is the ability to use words in creating more complex linguistic messages in coherent speech used in particular situations. Most of them don't lose the so-called automatic speech. They lose more complex linguistic messages, creating complex linguistic messages. Arnold Pick, 1851 to 1924, he was a German psychiatrist. He also endorsed Jackson's view about holism and stated that aphasic disturbances are connected to loss of propositional use of language, that there are two distinct moments when we are trying to speak, a psychological moment and a linguistic moment in articulating language. Much later in Henry Head, 1861 to 1940, once again supported Jackson's view and said that aphasia results in damage to voluntary language, not automatic language. These ideas continued up into, until 1960s with Kurt Goldstein, who emphasized disturbances also exist to sensory motor processes in aphasia, not just Broca's area, the Wernicke's area, but even sensory motor processes are involved in language disturbance following brain damage. In 1941, Roman Jakobson talked of analogies between stages of language development and language dissolution in aphasia, that there is some kind of mirroring happens between the way children acquire language and the way aphasics lose language. It was in his 1956 publication that Jackson discussed the distinction between paradigmatic versus syntagmatic disturbances. Paradigmatic are selection of linguistic units, problem with selecting appropriate linguistic unit, whereas syntagmatic is combining appropriate linguistic units. So, paradigmatic is a vertical relationship among linguistic unit, syntagmatic is a horizontal relationship. In aphasia, only one of these two will be affected, is what Jakobson proposed. So, you can either have similarity disorder, which means the patient is unable to select appropriate word and therefore he experiences anomia, lack of ability to name things, or contiguity disorder like agrammatism, in which the agrammatic aphasic patient has problem combining units. So, either selection or combination, those are the terms that Jakobson used in describing aphasias. in the 60s, in 1964, Luria also came up with a classification of aphasia, a three-way classification: sensory, semantic, and amnestic. And eventually, drawing again on Jacobson's similarity or selectional disorders, which Jackson called dynamic, and afferent type of decoding disorders as opposed to encoding or contiguity disorders. So basically, there is a coming together of these ideas in typologizing aphasic disturbances. Now we have come into the 20th century in neurolinguistics. Slowly, by 1980s or so, we had neuroimaging techniques, electrophysiological techniques, where you could monitor brain waves when you are listening, speaking, listening to music, or producing a noun in relation to a verb, whatever task lying in the scanner. So, with the development of technology, the neurolinguistics research, enhanced quite a bit, and there is also gradually consensus is emerging to say that we cannot separate language from general cognition, that there is a relationship between general cognition and language. This consensus, which is still emerging, was made possible due to a number of cross-linguistic studies involving multilingual patients, not just English-speaking patients, and also studies of cortical reorganization that happens inside the brain after you have had brain damage and you are recovering. What exactly is happening in the brain? With the help of neuroimaging techniques, you can monitor and see whether areas next to the damaged area is taking over the function. So, reorganization of cortical functions could be studied. So, many of these issues will be elaborated in each of the next 14 modules. So, this module's aim was only to just introduce you to the major questions addressed by neurolinguistics and tell you the scope of neurolinguistics. To sum up what I have said in this lecture, neurolinguistics is part of cognitive neuroscience, which is a general term within which cognitive neuroscience is much larger. It deals with many processes, but neurolinguistics focus is on language acquisition, language processing, and language disorders. We discussed about some of the major questions neurolinguistics is trying to address, and we talked about the history of this discipline during the past century also, along the lines of three major approaches: localism or localizationist approach, which says that a specific part of the brain is responsible for a specific function. On the other hand, the associationism promoted by Wernicke and later Geschwind and others says that it is the connections between two areas which are more important than specific areas that are important. In other words, in order to process language and use language, we do draw upon images from one part of the brain which have to also be connected to auditory impressions and then to the motor sensory impressions. So, associationism talks about connections across different areas of the brain. Associationism eventually in the 90s became 80s and 90s and all, it became connectionism. The last approach called holism basically says that aphasia should be thought of as damage to propositional speech and not automatic speech. So, holism looks at language in a more comprehensive sense of complex ideational propositions are what is affected when there is damage to different parts of the brain, and the damage can be in relation to selecting a particular representation or combining those representations. We have talked about representations as the specific linguistic units or even words. So, when there is a selection problem, the brain damaged patient experiences difficulty in naming things. It's a paradigmatic relation, as opposed to agrammatism, for instance, can be thought of as combining those units. So it is this two-way distinction is discussed in the third approach. If you have any doubts, I suggest you consult the e-text for more details. Thank you.